Oh, what's up, you fellas? Hairs here. What are we talking about today? Oh yeah, we're gonna do another RPG review. This time, I wanna talk to you fellas about Dark Cloud.
Can I just pop in real quick? I really think that I should be doing this because I don't think anyone can understand you.
Bro, everyone knows what I'm saying, man. My vocab. Bro, I know all the words, man. You just make up words that no one's ever heard of before. Where did you go to school, egghead?
Yeah, I'm getting nowhere. This is hopeless.
Oh, that stink fella just wants to take over my channel, eh? What do you fellas reckon? Should I ever let him do a review?
Nope.
Oh, Dark Cloud, man. Yet another one of those awesome RPGs made by those fellas at level 5. It was released way back in 2001 on the PS2. I'm proud as to say that Dark Cloud was one of the first RPGs I purchased when the PS2 came out. I still got the original copy, cuz. I'm reviewing the PS4 version for you fellas today, eh? And once again, old Haz has snagged that platinum trophy. Yeah. Bro, I challenge you all to get on my level, eh? Show me those screenshots with your platinum trophies for Dark Cloud so we can be brothers and sisters in RPG arms. Alright, let's get into it, man. Dark Cloud is 17 years old now, you fellas. So I'm just gonna start off with tackling how this game looks. It's dated, man. Old Haz isn't gonna try and tell you smart fellas otherwise, eh? Both the art and the animations are old and have a charming clunkiness to them. Not bad animation per se, it just feels old, you can tell, man. Even though the resolution is now 1080p, nothing has been updated here for the PS4 version. Having said that, playing this game and beating it all over again, it was so much fun, bro. Nostalgia kicked in and the graphical woes just melted away, man. I think it's funny that as long as the game is good, graphics don't matter much to old Haz. Character controls are remarkably simple and straightforward, eh? Something you fellas know old Haz is a fan of. You won't need much of a tutorial on what buttons do what, eh? You also won't get arthritis after playing for an hour like some other games where you need to be constantly rolling natural 20s on dex checks, eh? Just to keep your character alive in combat, bro! I think the old PS2 controllers limited the game designers back then to execute as much as they could with as few buttons as possible, eh? And this is still a design ethic I believe in wholeheartedly. There are two main areas you will be spending the majority of your time in, towns and dungeons. Firstly, let's talk about those dungeons. The biggest thing here is that they are all completely randomly generated, man. No two dungeons will ever be the same.
Oh, level 5, bro, already you got old Haz's interest peaked.
Combining this with the random treasure chest locations, enemies to fight and their loot drops, and then some hidden back areas which are located on every floor, basically, you have created the ultimate grind fest for old Haz. There are three items to find on every floor, eh? A map, which reveals the layout of the current floor. A magical crystal, which shows you the location of all the monsters and the treasure chests. These are super helpful, eh? Because you'll need to defeat all the monsters until one of them drops a key that will allow you to progress onto the next floor. Using the fog of war method to uncover the dungeon maps is a stroke of genius, man. It helps convey that sense of discovering things in the random dungeons. One thing, real quick, while you're in the dungeons, players have a thirst meter that is constantly running down. You gotta visit a fountain or drink some bottled water to keep your character hydrated, eh? If your character is thirsty and you don't drink, your health is constantly draining and if it hits zero, you die, bro. By the way, old Haz wants to point out that without an item called a Dran's Feather, he would probably be telling you fellas that the dungeons became extremely long-winded and straight up brutally long in some cases. So don't forget to take those with you whenever you go into the dungeons. They help you run like 3 times as fast as normal. Oh, like the Flash, cuz. The town hubs are essentially where you will be outside of being in a dungeon. There is no open world or large linear maps to traverse. Instead, think of the game's progression more like a handful of towns that you will move instantly between when you finally have that option. To start off with, your first town hub will just be a completely empty mass of open field, eh? It used to be your hometown, but it was actually destroyed by this huge purple fella in the sky called the Dark Genii.
It's pronounced genie? Yeah, nah, bro.
The Dark Genii shot down some energy that blew away and sealed the houses, people, and even water in these little things called Atla. Your job as the hero is to rebuild your town. You do this by entering the dungeons and collecting Atla, by using this fancy armband that was given to you by this old fella called the Fairy King. It's called the Atlamilia.
Bro, I don't know what that egghead was talking about, eh? My vocabulary is wicked, man. I've just proven it to you, fellas.
Yous use the Atlamilia to collect the pieces of Atla. Oh, they kind of look like Earth-type Pokeballs, eh? And then when you get back to town, you transform them back into the things that they were before they got blasted by the Dark Genii. Going deeper into any dungeon yields more Atla, uncovering more houses, buildings, and people to talk and interact with in the town, which in turn gives you more things to rebuild. You will end up setting up shops, fishing holes, and sorting out likes and dislikes amongst the inhabitants. Yep, you heard old Haz. Some of these fellas don't like living next to other fellas, eh? So you have to make sure that all the fellas are happy in order to proceed to the next town. You can pretty much rebuild the town however you want, eh? But the ultimate goal is to ensure all of the fellas in there are happy. Some of them will make some funny ass requests, say, like they want their house to face east or something. And then some other fella will want to be next to the water, and some other dude will want some forest around him. Oh bro, you get the idea. Essentially, that is the absolute genius behind this game's design. The main part of the story development is tied to one of the biggest, most addictive and proven mini games of all time. Town building. Pro tip from old Haz. Every time you fellas go down into a deeper level of the dungeon, finishing it will spawn some little treasure chests up in your town. They appear in random ass places, eh? So be sure to always look around for those when you get back home. Some of them can be even hidden off screen.
Oh man, so smash on that search button, bro, otherwise you'll miss heaps of loot, eh?
There are some special items, eh? There's one that will permanently increase your HP so you can take more hits, and there's a defense one so you can take less damage per hit. And there's one more that will permanently increase your thirst meter, so you can run for longer in the dungeons before needing a drink. You don't really level up your characters in this game, and you don't have EXP to spend on things either. Instead, level 5 has you grinding on monsters and opening up chests for items that increase the power of your weapons. It works like this. They start off really basic, eh, having just one or two attachment slots on them. You fight enemies and gain absorption points, which are used to level up the weapon. But you also grab attachment loot as you take the enemies down or open chests. Those can be slotted into those empty attachment slots, giving your weapons boosts to attack damage, durability, and any number of elemental damage bonuses. Then when your weapon reaches maximum absorption, you can level it up, which permanently fuses those attachments to the weapon and then reopens those slots again. Once a weapon hits level 5, you can also turn it into something called a synth sphere. It's a really special attachment which basically condenses all of the power of that weapon into an attachment, which can of course be slotted onto a new weapon. Creating a synth sphere will also destroy the original weapon, but it's totally worth it, man, because it condenses 60% of the stats of the whole weapon. It's by far the fastest way to level up your weapons, man. Sounds awesome already, eh? But there's one other thing to point out here. There's a weapon tree for every character in the game, so choose carefully, eh, because not every weapon can be leveled up to the most powerful version.
Or just be like me and collect them all, man.
Lastly, I cannot move forward here without mentioning that your weapons have something called durability. You need to carry or find repair powders to keep them sharp while fighting enemies, eh? Each hit on an enemy will reduce that durability, and if it ever reaches zero, the weapon will break and disappear completely. I've heard that this can really spoil some fella's day, eh, but I'm way too good for that, so I got no idea what that feels like. Combat is another high point for Dark Cloud. For the time it was released, I reckon it was one of the very few RPGs to throw enemies as visible entities on the screen to fight right then and there. Don't forget, bro, this is 2001, eh? All those RPGs back then used to be all arena-based or random battle-based. Not Dark Cloud, bro. You see that enemy, you just take it down, man. No running up to touch them to initiate that fight in another screen. Even though the combat itself is really simple, from the very first enemies you meet to the dragons and giant armored knights in the final dungeons, the enemies and combat is varied enough to keep you guessing. You will fight standard melee enemies, ranged enemies, mages, shielded enemies, and some that are even a combination of those things, eh? All enemies have strengths and weaknesses for you to try and figure out how to exploit. As you progress through the game and finish building those towns, you will move to new ones and meet more playable characters who will join your team, and those followers all fight with different weapons, eh? Occasionally, the game will force you to rely on those other characters to progress, so it pays to spend some time playing with them and leveling up their weapons. There are some cool boss fights in the game, and they will often require some smart thinking and use of multiple characters to take down. One in particular is known to be frustratingly difficult to beat. Oh, but old Haz is never threatened by these claims. I know, your mind is blown and you can't even wait anymore. I can hear you saying to me, "But Haz, this sounds so great. Is there anything I need to know before I head off and buy it right now?"
Oh, hold up, Cuzzy, let me get in a few more things.
The audio in this game is nothing extraordinary, eh? But it does the job, and some of the town themes are extremely relaxing when you find yourself spending hours fishing. The dungeon music never really grated on my nerves either, which is definitely worth mentioning as you will spend 60 plus hours in there. Story wise, this is a very straightforward call to action for a bunch of heroes to save the world from the dark Genii. I quite like this in this instance because it really allows the gameplay to take center stage. With all of the mini games, dungeon delving, leveling up of weapons, I honestly would forget the story if it was any more complicated. Lastly, I have to call your attention to the fishing mini game. Level 5 is just geniuses when it comes to this stuff, eh? Catching the fish and setting size records to earn fishing points is one of the only ways to grab yourself some valuable gemstones which can be used as attachments on your weapons. Those gemstones provide massive stats boosts and are probably one of the fastest ways to level up and max out your weapons. There are also some secret hidden fishes that can only be caught at certain times of the day with certain baits. You fellas are going to have to do your research on that, eh? Because old Haz isn't going to give it away. If I have to pick some negative things out, the first would be that there are no save points, eh? You got to save it manually. And you can't do it in the dungeon. It's also very easy to accidentally save over your friend's save game, eh? But I would never do that, man. Breaking your weapon while fighting a new enemy you have never encountered can and probably will happen to you at some point. This can be pretty brutal if you have already spent something like 20 hours grinding on that weapon and leveling it up, eh? The last niggly thing, and it's pretty minor, is that the cameras are fixed inside the buildings. And the location of some of the treasure chests is off screen, so you can actually never see them.
Oh, that's just a cheeky way of sorting out those casual gamers from me and you, eh? We're hardcore, man.
Oh, I take my beanie off to you, Level 5, for creating this perfect blend of mini games, gameplay, town building, and grind. It simply never gets boring to play. There is post-game content also for those who want it, in the form of a super intense dungeon. It's 100 levels deep, man. It's called the Demon Shaft. That will seriously test your weapons and skills to the limit. I genuinely feel like this game deserves to be in everyone's collection, eh?
So all in all, I give this game 8.5 Genii's out of 10. Oh, hey you fellas. Real quick, don't forget to tap on those like and subscribe buttons, eh? And ding-a-ling that bell. Hurry up, man. I'll wait for you to do it now. Quickly, I haven't got all day. I've got to get on to my next review for you, fellas. See ya.